Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this lecture about antimicrobial resistance. And I'm really pleased to give this to you. And today I would like to show you the problem of this emerging healthcare problem, the scope of it, and also ways that we are able to counter this in the near future. So before I go into my lecture, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Chris Arts. I'm an associate professor of translational biomaterials. And I have this function both at the Maastricht University Medical Center and the Technical University of Eindhoven. Opposite and next to that, I am also the principal investigator of the NWA, the Nationale Wetenschapsagenda, DARPA project, that is focusing exclusively on antimicrobial resistance. So, to give you a scope of my talk, it will be gloomy. Especially the beginning of this talk will be gloomy. Antimicrobial resistance is a real serious healthcare problem, as I'm going to show you, and it really needs our attention. If we do not address this problem properly, in about 2050, yearly 10 million people or more will die because of this problem. And in that way, it has surpassed cancer and cardiovascular disease combined as a leading cause of death globally. So this is a clipping from a recent newspaper in the Netherlands where they call it AMR, the unstoppable killer, or in Dutch, the onstuitbare sluipmoordenaar. And that's really what it is. Although this problem is known for already almost two decades, in the Netherlands we have a false sense of security about AMR. We do not see it as a problem, and in that lies part of the problem. The reason we don't see this is because we have regulated antibiotics in our country since the 50s, which was a really smart move. Next to that, our food and our water are very clean, devoid of antibiotics, so in that case not able to give us antimicrobial resistance. And also the occurrence of, let's say, Staphylococcus aureus, MRSA, infection in the Netherlands, total less than 10 globally in the country, or nationally in the country. So, in that case, people don't see this really as a problem. I'm going to show you that it really is and why we should address this. So first, I would like to talk to you about infection. Infection is an invasion of any microorganism in the body, and that will lead to serious damage of the local tissues or your health. The incidence is depending on the tissue where you look at, but if you look in hard tissues like bone, the incidence should be below 1% if you implant a total hip prosthesis, and it can be up to 50% in case of high energy trauma with open fractures. In soft tissues, these numbers are different, as you can see on the screen, and they range between 12 and 30%. So all in all, that means that about 1 in 3 patients with a surgery in the abdomen can get an infection, which is really high. The spread of infection is multiple, and it can go to the skin, to the transfer of body fluid. You can take it in while breathing. You can also touch an object or a person who has a contaminant on his body or surface. So there are various ways to catch an infection. And also, as I said before, it can occur in soft tissues, like your abdomen. It can occur in your skin. It can occur in the hard tissues of your body, like your bones. And it's especially prevalent on the surface of implants, like cardiac pacemakers or total knee or total hip implants. Next to the implant infection, we also have infection in the heart tissues, and we call this osteomyelitis, infection of the bone or bone marrow. And in this picture, you can see that it starts as a very small site on the left picture. Over time, the blood supply is blocked, and this leads to a sequester, so a section of dead bone inside your body that is capsuled off by other tissues. But over time, you also see that the bone will react. There will be a cannulation, and fluids will go out to the bone and eventually to the skin outside the body. And this fluid is called pus. As you can imagine, this is hard to treat. And you cannot only treat the skin, but you also have to treat the underlying pathology. For those who have problems with a little bit more visual medical images, I give you now a fair warning for my next slide, because I'm going to show an infected implant. And as you can see immediately on the left image, This is far more severe. This is a total knee implant that has become infected and that needs to be removed from the patient. Usually, directly after surgery, we do a culturing to see if there's really an infection. And if not, we culture in the lab. And if there's a deep infection, we have to remove the implant completely. In most cases, we are able to successfully treat the infection and put either in a new implant or come up with another solution. But also in about 10-15% of the cases, infection with multibacteria in the knee can lead to amputation. And that's even the case in the Netherlands with our excellent healthcare system. So some options before we start talking about treatment. Bacteria will persist endlessly in dead tissue. So unless you take this dead tissue away in the treatment, you will not cure the infection. Also, if there's a biofilm is formed, and I will talk about this a little bit later in my talk, bacteria will persist in this biofilm endlessly. They are not able to be reached by the host immune system of the body, and also antibiotics can almost not penetrate the biofilm and cannot touch the bacteria and kill them. So this is a really big issue. So necrosis, so removal of dead tissue is necessary. You can only do this surgically. And also, we know that the biofilm is not removed by systematic antibiotics. These are key things to keep in mind for later on in my talk. Extensive debridement, and debridement is a nice word for taking away dead, cutting away dead tissue, is the key part of our infection treatment. If you do not take away all the dead tissue, then it will never heal. So that's important. And you have to be aggressive. You have to take all the infected tissues and maybe even an additional centimeter of healthy tissue to make sure that you have cut away everything that is infected. So this is really important. And then there's a problem because large pharma is disinvesting their research into antibiotics. They cannot get their money back because development of an antibiotic will take 20 years, will cost around 10 billion, and they cannot get their money back. So you see a worrisome trend globally that these large pharma medical devices are not investing in new pipelines of new products. And combined with the occurrence of antimicrobial resistance, this is a really problem, worrisome trend. So as I showed and talked about in this film, you can see this. Top left, you see the incision, and we use a dye to color the dead tissue. When you open the wound a little bit more, top right image, you see that a lot more is infected than based on your initial assessment. Then we clean the dead tissue, and we also clean the bone all the way to the center. And in this case, we leave biomaterials behind, and these biomaterials will elute antibiotics for about a period of 2 weeks to kill the local infection that is still remaining. And after that, we can reconstruct the bone defect. But you can imagine that these treatments are very difficult. They are lengthy, they are very expensive, and they fail in a fairly high number of times. So we need to do this better. And then the problem even worsens even more, because then you see that bacteria are starting to develop antimicrobial resistance. So the antibiotics are not as effective anymore as they were 10, 20 years ago. More and more bacteria are not susceptible for their working mechanism, and this is complicating our treatment. In the image, you see two ways to get an antimicrobial resistance. One, the right cycle is through human contact in your environment. When you touch people with infection, you can transfer bacteria that are already resistant, and they can multiply in your body. And the other way, that's not so much occurring in the Netherlands, is through the food chain. As I said before, our food and our water is very clean, and only very low trace amounts of antibiotics are in there. And usually they are not enough to give you antimicrobial resistance. But other countries are not so lucky. So how does this antimicrobial resistance develop? So in the beginning, you have a lot of germs in your body, but only a few are resistant. Antibiotics will kill most of the bacteria, but of course the resistant bacteria, they will remain. And over time, they will survive and start to multiply again when the antibiotic effect has worn off after a couple of weeks. And then these resistant bacteria will also multiply again. And the problem is they can also transfer their resistance using extracellular DNA. So they can give this property to other bacteria in the surrounding areas. And that's really hard to counter for us. So this is a real big problem. And this is then what happens, the emergence of superbugs. And superbugs is a class of bacteria that are resistant to the majority of the current antibiotics. So you can imagine that if you get an infection with these kinds of bacteria, there's not much we can do. Either your host immune system can overcome the infection, or it cannot, and that would probably mean that the patient will die. So to give you an idea about the occurrence of this problem and also the scope of this problem, this graph shows you when new antibiotics were introduced into the market in the last about 40, 50 years. And you see that with penicillin, it took about 23 years before bacteria became resistant. But you also see that with new types of antibiotics and new generations, this time frame is getting shorter, shorter and shorter. So the bacteria can adapt quicker than we can develop new antibiotics. And also, given the fact that we are not really developing new antibiotics and there are a few pipelines that are almost to a product, this is really a problem for our direct future. So this is a scope of the problem. You can see this world map. And there you can see the more purple a country is, the higher the antimicrobial resistance of Staph aureus are in that country. You can see there are major differences between Asia, Europe, but also the US, Southern America, Africa. In this map, Europe is still doing quite well, but if we take a closer look, we see that it's not really the case, and actually only the Netherlands, the Scandinavian countries and Iceland really have really low microbial resistant issues. I said before, this is mainly because we regulated antibiotics to our general practitioners for a long time. You just cannot buy it in the shelf, you have to really get it from the doctors. Our food is clean and we do not give it because we just want to have it. So that's a real good issue. And we are still in the lead because of these decisions that were made 50, 60 years ago. But infection is catching up. Because of the new immigrations into Europe from other countries, we see new bacteria that we have not seen in the Netherlands in the last 30 years. So the problem is really getting worse. And also, if you look at the joint registries, so every country has to register all the hip and knee joints they put in patients and follow them for a very long time. In this case, over 40 years already. This is data. And there you actually can see that in the left image, you see the percentage of revision for total hip arthroplasty. And what you actually notice is that the infection percentage is going up. It's not going down, it's going up. One of the reasons for this is that our total hip patients from 30 years ago were not as nearly as active as today. The other problem is also we are putting in a lot more total hips. So percentual-wise, of course, it is expected that these numbers will go up. But this, of course, is a really big problem as well. And combined with the earlier problems, this is getting the problem, it's a snowballing effect. And it's making the problem worse, worse and worse. If you want to look at literature from the World Health Organization or any other organization in this field, there are vast shelves of reports highlighting this problem. And most of them claim that if we do not really tackle this crisis in 2050, about 10 million people will die yearly because of this problem. How big is the problem now? Well, this is data from the United States, about 6 years old already. And in this case, they stated that due to the problem of antimicrobial resistance, they already had 2 million more illnesses a year. And also about 26,000 deaths purely dedicated to this problem. And this number is going up exponentially. At the moment, it is already more than 67,000. And these are data that are only 2 years old. and the US is now slowly going towards 100,000 a year. And you can see that this is not an evenly gain, this is exponential gain. So what are the costs of this IMR problem? It's estimated that at the moment 23 people die in the US about 7 years ago, 700,000 die worldwide. And this already costs the US healthcare system about $20 billion a year. You can imagine that if this problem is going to be 100 or 1,000 fold worse, the cost will rise exponentially. And also the loss of life will be dramatic. And the other thing is then that at that time in 2050, you can see that antimicrobial resistance has caught up with cancer, diabetes, and also cardiovascular disease as a leading cause of death. So tackling it now is really necessary. So this is an image, a video from Harvard that will show you the problem. And I will narrate it a little bit from the side. So they actually made a very, very large petri dish where they could load on bacteria, and they had different bands in this dish. On the outside, they had no antibiotics. In the second band, they had one time antibiotics, so the normal volume to kill bacteria. Then 10 times, 100 times, in the middle, they had 1,000 times the amount of antibiotic needed to kill the bacteria normally. And then they loaded in bacteria, and they could move inwards. And on the video, they are displayed as white. And you can see that they will easily move in this zero antibiotic area. And then they need to pause, but then a mutant appears, and in a very short amount of time, they can also strive in this one-time antibiotic that would normally kill them. And then they have to pause again when they hit the 10 times the amount of antibiotics to kill them. But you can see that they even in this area spread quite quickly. Of course, then they hit the 100 times antibiotics barrier. They need to pause again. But even then, you see, it takes only one or two mutations for them to go into this field. And in the end, and this only takes 11 days and about 7 mutations, you see that they are able to survive in the environment with 1,000 times the amount of antibiotic that would normally kill them. So when I first saw this image, I was terrified, because this is antimicrobial resistant in action, and it's a really effective process. They just need 7 mutations to go this far. And we never give 1,000 times the antibiotic needed to kill the normal type of bacteria. And also, they can do this in 11 days. And maybe then, that means that giving antibiotic for a long period of time doesn't make any sense. There's still a lot of unknowns in this field that we need to address. So in conclusion of my first part, AMR is a current problem that is expected to grow exponentially. These superbugs are really already here. They are not a fiction. They are already in the population, and they are rapidly emerging, and we really cannot counter them with antibiotics anymore. There are, of course, major differences in antimicrobial resistance percentage in between countries, as I showed. We are still very lucky in the Netherlands. And I think that this is mainly because we regulated antibiotics already from the 50s onwards, and that was a really good choice. But of course, other countries cannot simply duplicate this and catch up 40 or 50 years. It's not possible for them. So I think that the focus on solution needs to be prioritized, not only in academia or industry, but also globally and societal, because this is a really big problem, and we need to invest in new antibiotics or other technology to counter antimicrobial resistant bacteria. And I think, from my personal perspective and from my experience, that antibiotics are no longer the preferred solution. We should go away from antibiotics. We are far too dependent on antibiotics. And in my opinion, other technologies, such as material technology, can also offer us a hand, and in that way also limit our use of antibiotics, so we can still use it in 20 years' time. So before I go into an example of implant implant-related infection, I need to show you how an implant-related infection occurs and what actually happens. And before I can do that, I need to tell you about the biofilm. The biofilm is how bacteria live on the surface. This is an example from the hot stones in Yellowstone Park and or for the glacier in Antarctica. And this is one of the most resistant forms of life. And every bacteria in nature almost always lives in the biofilm community. So it's their way how to connect and how to protect themselves. Mijn pointer is weg. Unfortunately, this biofilm formation also happens on implant surfaces. So if you would assume this is a hip implant and you look at the surface of the hip implant, there is called a wait for the surface. As soon as you implant the prosthesis in the body, there's a wait. And that wait can be won by your own body cells, and they cover the implant surface first, then the chance on infection is really low. But if bacteria win, they cover and colonize the implant surface, form a biofilm, and an infection almost surely to happen. The problem is, as soon as they form this biofilm, they lower their metabolism rate, and they also encapsulate themselves in this biofilm, so they cannot be reached by the host body system response, and also not by antibiotics. So smart move on their part, but really a problem for us. And you can see in the image that they can do this really quickly. They have a small attachment with van der Waal forces already in a couple of minutes. And in about a day or 2 days, they have irreversible attachment. And you only can get them off with high level of sonication equipment. So it also happened, and this can take a couple of months. It can also take 8 to 10 or even longer years. Somehow these bacteria sense when your body is not feeling so well and when your resistance is down, and then they can speed up their multiplication rate and they do a secondary dispersion. Usually then they go directly into the bloodstream and they can also provide sepsis, which can be a life-threatening condition for a patient. So the composition of such a biofilm is extracellular DNA, proteins and polysaccharides, long sugar chains. And as I said before, when they are in this biofilm, they lower their metabolism and the rate of multiplication, and the body doesn't see them as a threat. So they can stay in there for a long time until they decide to come out and you have an acute infection. So what are current solutions? Of course we have solutions. We can coat an implant with, let's say, silver or other substances. And this is an example of a knee implant coated with silver. And we actually have quite good results with this. But of course, this is a very expensive implant and you have to decide when this is indicated or not. You can also put implants on other prostheses, and I show some examples on the slide on the right for your information. And various literature findings in this field have proven that these implants can work, usually also for a longer period of time. And if you look at follow-up in hips, total knees, a long time follow-up is about 20 years. The implant should be in the body for at least that long. So we have good results, but you cannot use them mainstream because they are too expensive and we never know who's going to get an infection or not. Also, what is currently being done by various partners, both in industry and academic, is people are looking at antimicrobial coatings. And this is a really good review from a couple of years ago that is highlighting what are the needs for these kind of coatings. And how can you really prove that they are efficient and also safe, not only in the beginning, but also over time. Because if you have an antimicrobial compound on this surface that comes off in only 96 days, it might be so that after 4 weeks or 4 months, this prosthesis still gets infected. That's of course not what we want. So optimization is for sure possible in this field. This is another way that when you coat an implant with a hyaluronic acid combined with an antimicrobial compound, so it's like gluing the plate just before implantation, and that would hamper the attachment of the bacteria on the plate surface. So that's another way to go. And something that has recently been published from the University Center in Leiden is they do induction heating. So they heat the implant just before implantation to about 70 degrees, and then bacteria cannot attach. The implant, of course, will cool off in the body, and the patient will not feel that. But in that way, you might avoid attachment early on of bacteria during hip or joint surgery. So there are for sure options that we can use to tackle this problem. But it's not enough. And that's why last year we were lucky that we were granted funding for the NWA DARPA project. And NWA stands for the National Science Agenda, Nationale Wetenschapsagenda. That is really helping us tackle this problem from a material point of view. And I will show you a little bit on what we aim to do in this project and why I think this project is so important. Well, it's a really big consortium of academia partners, industry partners, societal partners, but also, let's say, the Federation of Medical Specialists, RIVM. So in my opinion, we have the entire knowledge chain and all the stakeholders in here. And that's really important, because you can develop all the technology you want, but if people are not want to buy it or use it in clinic, then it doesn't make sense. So you have to involve all these people early on, otherwise it's meaningless. And then also part of the NWA means that you have to build an interdisciplinary consortium. So you don't have to only look in your own discipline, but it should be broadly applicable. So we have brought together pharma science, medical science, molecular science, imaging, but also the social sciences, behavioral sciences, and communication sciences. And the companies also have a major role to play. They bring in quality assurance and regulatory affairs expertise, device regulations, they have already pathways, workflow pathways. They can also help us with marketing, getting the information out, and they are important in a knowledge chain. And then, of course, if you look more to the clinical implementation, you do fundamental research first, applied research later, clinical research, and then you also want to steer behavior. And a long time, people have said this is not possible. But at the moment, I go shopping wearing a mouth mask. And I've been doing this for 3 months. I've heard for the last decade, this people will never do that. But I say, if the need is high enough, like COVID, they will do it. But they need to see the urgency. Then we can steer that behavior. And given the time, I would also like to give you an example why, what's the difference between a virus like COVID and a bacterial antimicrobial resistant problem that I'm talking about now. In general, with the virus problem, you have the most casualties or the problems early on. Over time, the reproduction cycle of a virus gets less efficient, and then they become less virulent, so aggressive, and then you have all the people who are surviving or have little problems. The antimicrobial bacteria work the other way around. In the beginning, they are only resistant to a single antibiotic. But over time, when they survive and they meet other resistant antibiotics and take on their genetic markers, they can become superbugs. So they will become more aggressive over time. And that's a major difference compared to the viruses. And I therefore also think that this problem is not only going to grow exponentially, but it's also going to get worse. And it will have a major impact not only on orthopedic surgery, but on every type of surgery in the hospital, because everybody will have more infections. And all these infections can be treated less optimal. So combined, this will give us a lot of new problems in this field. So the aim of this project, as I was just presenting, is to prepare the Netherlands for the post-antibiotic era. And we also want to minimize the impact of AMR in the Netherlands. I'm very honest, we cannot stop AMR. It's not possible. But we can try to minimize the impact. And we are going to do this mainly from a materials perspective. We want to develop new antimicrobial technologies that are not based on antibiotics or work together with antibiotics as a combination therapy for the prevention and eradication of implant surface infection, infection in hard tissues and infection in soft tissues. We also want to establish a technology push to get products to market quicker by making an optimized chain of models to test new technology, not only in our project but also for future projects. We also want to assess the safety and efficacy of the projects we develop in our own projects, and then ideally roll one, two, or maybe three of them out into the clinic. Some of the technologies are already close to clinic, some are just starting in the lab, and they will need 10 or 15 years. So we also go up broader than the scope of this six-year project. As I said, we want to enhance the therapeutic effect of current antibiotics by combining them with other antimicrobial compounds, such as copper or silver or zinc or something else. And then there's a second aim, the social science or the behavioral science. We really want to increase awareness. We think that if you want to generate a public change in behavior, you need to create awareness to steer this. If people do not see this as a problem and still remain to see this as not a problem, the solutions are not going to be uptaken into the clinic. So we have a big play here that we need to make both the general public but also healthcare professionals aware of the severity of this problem that is coming, that we cannot stop it, and it will really influence our lives in 20 years' time. We also need to develop a trust relationship with the healthcare professionals so they are willing to use our materials, and of course with insurance companies, so they're willing to pay for them. We also need to work on the advisory bodies, so they will also reimburse the insurance companies to make use of these technologies possible. And we also want to establish technology pools. So if people are aware that this is a problem and they're asking for new technology that we have available, then the knife is cutting on two sides, as they say in Dutch. So all in all, a broad scope, not only technology and not only academic research, but also awareness and an awareness campaign. But before we can start this new campaign, we also need to know why did the other previous campaigns did not succeed or did not really get the result that we wanted. So we're going to research that as well. And we can use COVID as a case study on how to do things better. So for future solutions in our project, and I'm now talking solely on material technology to tackle the biofilm, I leave everything else outside of the scope. We can do two things. We can prevent biofilm formation by changing the surface of the implant, making it more hostile for the bacteria to attach, or we can facilitate biofilm eradication. And in our project, we're going to use antimicrobial peptides, antimicrobial coatings, or a new combination therapies. This graph shows you graphically how this is going to be done. So we can try to prevent adherence of the bacteria to the surface. We can try to stop initiation of a biofilm formation. If they are free-flowing and are not protected by a biofilm, the body will kill them, but it will take time. And also we can stop the maturation of the biofilm. So these are three areas that we can really have a success in a short frame. Some of these will already should be working within 6 years. And you can also do this from another part, that you have active compounds on the surface of the implant, really preventing bacteria to attach. So let's say a small source that are sticking up so they cannot attach, or compounds that are leaching from the surface of the implant or from a coating that will attack bacteria in the vicinity before they can attach to the implant. So these are more, let's say, active compound technologies. And we will take about 5 to 10 years to develop them. It will take a little bit longer. So substances that can destroy the biofilm, or they can destroy the persister cells that can form a second biofilm. We can also look at the quorum cleansing and the enzymes. And quorum sensing is the way bacteria communicate with each other. If you can disrupt communication, they will not build an ideal biofilm. It will be more open and maybe then the antibiotics can go in there. So that's another way of thinking that we have not really explored so far. And then also there are substances like, a small biological explosive that can stimulate the biofilm to blow up itself, make holes in it so the bacteria can get out, but also the antibiotics can penetrate the biofilm and clear it from the inside out. So in another scheme, we can prevent adherence, initiation, maturation, or we can really eradicate the biofilm once it is formed. The upper part is relatively speaking easy to accomplish. This part is relatively difficult to accomplish because this biofilm is such an unique structure that is so well adapted to prevent removal that we really need to combine new ideas in this field. And I will give you an example later on. So this is one of these new materials that we have developed, S53P4 bioactive glass. It really looks like glass granules. And this is a project that has been developed by one of our partners in Finland, and it's very interesting. I'm going to stand a little bit in front of the screen now, because as soon as you put this product into the body, it is going to release ions from its surface. And these small ions will have a very local effect, and they will heighten the pH, but also the osmotic pressure. And bacteria can usually withstand one of them, but this combined attack, they cannot really defend against, and their cell walls will disintegrate. So it's like a mechanical attack on the cell wall integrity of the bacteria. So it works completely different as an antibiotic. And so far it has been tested on about 50 different antibiotic strains or bacterial strains, and they have not been resistant. I'm sure it's going to happen, but for them it's a really new problem that they are facing. And we have used this material in clinic in Maastricht and also some other hospitals in the Netherlands with really good, I would say excellent results in the last 10 years. So it's really important for us to start thinking outside the box, but also combining different insights from different specialties. And one of these insights is that we need to know more about this biofilm. Ideally, we want to visualize the biofilm. And here you see examples on the throat prostheses, but we want to visualize them on a molecular scale. And nowadays, with mass spectrometry, imaging and other techniques, this is possible. And we can look at the adhesion strength, the adhesion extent, the biomass of the biofilm, and also the composition of the matrix. And even it is our hope that we're developing a new system of imaging techniques at the Institute of Molecular Imaging in Maastricht, MVI, we would be able to determine the effect of a mutation of a bacteria on the biofilm construction. And that could give us new insights to tackle the biofilm formation, ideally from the inside out. If you know what the composition is and how it will change, we maybe can target these changes and in that way also eradicate the biofilm on the implant surfaces. We are going to develop this imaging system for the next 6 years, and I hope that both us but also other partners can really use it for the future in the development of new materials. So in conclusion of my talk, AMR is a current problem that's expected to grow exponentially in the near future. The superbugs are already here, they are not emerging, they are already here, and they are going to give us a lot of problems. And as I said, there are major differences in AMR between countries. So far the Netherlands has been lucky, but our luck is going to run out, and we have to start initiatives to minimize the impact of AMR. And our focus on solutions is broader than only the antibiotics. And this project, the DARTBAC project, is one of the examples for this. And then, as I showed, biomaterials like the bioactive glass can be a really good way to to target infection in a specific field. Of course, they are not suitable for every indication. You cannot introduce them in soft tissues because they will dissolve. So we need to make new formulation based on this line of thinking and even combine. The clinical data we have so far is that they are really effective. They have very low rates of complications, and the literature is really supporting their use. We should also focus on the prevention of biofilm formation, and if we can image the biofilm better and know how to tackle it, that would really help us with that. And overall, clinical outcomes are expected to severely worsen over time if you do not act now. I really truly believe this, and that's why I also wanted to present this talk to you. So we can easily lose the battle against the bacteria, but this will have devastating results, and it's better not to do it. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I would be happy to answer any questions you might have in the live connection feed. Thank you. Koud op de grond.
Hey, you're still here. So you like the video. If you want, subscribe and click the bell.